Good morning and welcome to worship at Madison Square. I am Jen Courtney, the associate pastor here, and it is good to have you with us on this Sunday in July. There are some announcements for the life and the work of the church, and so I hope you take note. First is that daily devotions continue Monday through Friday at noon. Monday and Tuesday, Thursday and Friday, they are reading the book Finding God in Ordinary Time. And on Wednesdays, they've invited me to share with them the scripture that will be used on the following Sunday so that we can discuss it and analyze it together. And it gives me, and I hope them, some insights and some inspiration as well, and makes worship a different opportunity for us. We hear things differently when we've already had them on our minds in the latter half of the week. So I encourage you to jump online and join us for that if you're able. We are 1 week away from opening our doors. We are not blind to the fact that Delta variant is prevalent in our community and hospitalization rates and positivity rates have ticked up a bit. We are not naive and we are not going about this blindly. We have consulted with the doctors on our reentry team and others who are a part of our worship leadership, and there are no drastic changes to our plans. We were already being abundantly cautious in our planning for reopening, and so we continue to do that. The most important thing is that the unvaccinated population right now is the population that is the most at risk for serious disease from COVID, hospitalization, and death as well. So if you are unvaccinated, if members of your household are unvaccinated, we still continue to encourage you to stay home. If you are eligible to be vaccinated and just have not yet, we encourage you to do so. If you cannot, or if you're not eligible yet because of your age or other health issues, then please be safe. Worshiping with us virtually while we are in person in this hybrid sense is the way that we will continue to do it going forward indefinitely. Not only will this disease stay with us for a bit longer, but we have people worship with us from out of town and people who worship with us who are on vacation but still want to be a part of what's going on. So don't be afraid to say, I'm not ready yet or it's not time yet, because worshiping online is a very valid way to do so. That being said, there are not many of you who have RSVP'd for next Sunday or the following. We've only had about 36 of you say that you were planning on coming. So if you have not done so yet and you do intend to come on the 25th or the 1st or both, please email Linda Nance or Carolyn DeHate, our office administrator, and let us know so that we can plan accordingly and make sure that everyone can have proper seating and physical distancing from one another. I really appreciate that. There are some other things that I hope that you took note of. If you printed or looked at your bulletin, the last page, page 4, is a document that shares with you some of the things that you can expect when we open the doors and you can come worship with us. We call this phase reuniting and adapting, and that's what we need all of us to be prepared to do. Families with children, you will be staying together as a household group in your pews. There won't be opportunities for children to have the playground area up at the front or to come forward for the chancel steps for children's time. We don't want to bring the unvaccinated people even closer to one another for the time being. Congregational singing will be refrained from. The choir is on vacation, and so we won't have a live choir, and congregational singing will be discouraged. We will still have a soloist singing, and we can participate in that way. We will be able to read the liturgy. We will have masks on. We don't have to shout that. We can whisper that quietly to ourselves so we can participate together in that way. We will have hand sanitizer. We will practice social distancing. We will practice mask wearing. We won't have formal fellowship time in our fellowship hall. We encourage you, if you are going to fellowship with one another after the service, to do so outdoors in a well-ventilated area. There is shade in the breezeway. There is shade in other places, even in the park across the street. So you can still fellowship in some comfort. We just won't have fellowship time indoors. The building will be open for restroom access, and right now it does not look like we will need to have any overflow seating at this time. If you have any questions or concerns about our procedures, why we're doing things the way we are, or what else we might do, or if you have any particular questions, feel free, please, to contact me by email or by phone or by text. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions that you have. I can refer you to our reentry team. Our doctors are open to answer questions of yours. We want you to feel comfortable when you come back and worship with us in person. And as I said, we will be hybrid for the indefinite future. So whatever way you choose to worship, let us prepare to worship together.
Esta es la fuente de identidad. This is the font of identity.
Esta es la mesa de sustento. This is the table of sustenance.
Esta es el libro de memoria y esperanza. This is the book of memory and hope.
Bienvenidos, people of God, welcome home.
Please join me in the call to worship. Come, friends, into the presence of God.
Joyfully we come to worship.
We will join the faithful family in praise.
Angels and saints and all of us together.
Imperfect though we are, we can join the heavenly chorus.
Shouting alleluias and making joyful noise.
Let us worship God together.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no under his wing, your refuge, his faithfulness, your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. Fear to his angels, he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Holy, holy, holy God, in your presence we bow. Your righteousness and truth are unblemished, and we are sinners in a need of grace. We have sinned both in what we have done and in what we have left undone. You sent your Son to show us the way, and yet we stray. Our arrogance, greed, and pride draw us away from the path to you, and into messes we cry out for you, your help to escape. Forgive us, God, for the endless cycle of repentance, sin, and shame we find ourselves in. Help us follow more closely the way, the truth, and the life you have given us. Christ did not come for those who claimed to be perfect or those who repented and became perfect. There are no such ones. We all struggle and are in need of new mercy every morning.
Thanks be to God for a love that won't quit. Friends, it's time to pass the peace of Christ with one another. You know the routine. If you are with loved ones, we encourage you to pass the peace of Christ to them. If there are those outside of your household that you want to share the peace with, we encourage you to do so electronically. And from our hearts to yours, may the peace of Christ be with you. Let us share the peace of Christ with one another. Starting next week, the Peace of Christ time will last a little longer because there will be people in this congregation, in this sanctuary, who want to make eye contact with one another and bow to one another or wave or share the peace sign. And we're going to allow them a little extra time than we give when we're just worshiping virtually to do that. So be prepared for that change as well. And now, those of you who are young and young at heart, gather closer to your screens. It's time for your children's moment. I'm going to share something with you today that I don't normally share. I'm going to give you a glimpse into my life, into my home, and into my backyard. So I'm going to share some things with you. I come from a family of farming people. My family, both sides, my mom's side and my dad's side, are from Western Kentucky. Two of my great-grandfathers were farmers. One was a coal miner, and one ran a general store. But all of them and their wives, my great-grandmothers and grandparents, have always, always had farms and gardens. Whether they lived in a house inside their small town, they had a garden in their backyard, or whether they lived on a lot of acreage and had a large garden and were professional farmers, they always had vegetable gardens. No matter what crop they sold, they always had vegetable gardens to eat from. And so that's in my blood. That's part of me. When I was a child, I was in the military family, and so we moved around a lot, and we couldn't always have gardens. We couldn't invest a lot of time into gardens. Then as a young adult, I moved around a lot from house to house and city to city, and again, it wasn't my land. I couldn't put a garden out there and didn't know how long I'd be there, so it was hard to invest the time. But when I settled down in San Antonio, that was one of the priorities, was I wanted to have a garden, and so I want to share with you the picture of my first garden in my backyard. This is my little garden. See, the problem was I started digging in the dirt in my backyard, and the ground was so hard and so rocky that I couldn't plant anything in it. Nothing was coming up. And so we built this garden box. It's about a foot tall, and this one was 4 feet deep and 8 feet wide, and we raised it, we filled it with good dirt from the dirt store and planted some things in it. The next picture shows you that it's full of plants. All those leaves are different kinds of vegetables. That box was full of plants very quickly. And after a couple of seasons of growing things, we realized we needed to have a bigger garden if we were going to have more plants. And so the next picture shows we made it 6 times bigger. It's now 8 feet deep and 24 feet long, and it takes up a big chunk of the backyard now. So the problem was, we ran into a new problem. We've got big dogs. Big dogs that like to jump on the fence and dig and get into trouble. So our next step in the garden was to protect the garden from the dogs. And so we started building a fence around the garden to keep the dogs out. And that started to work. The next picture shows the fence done, and we planted some new plants. And you can even see we have a pretend owl and a pretend cat in the garden to keep out the birds and the squirrels. So that worked for a little while. And we started to grow things and started to have a good garden. So I'll show you some of the things we grew. We have cauliflower and lots of lettuce and tomatoes. Those things that are purple and white are called turnips. I grew some turnips. And then the next picture shows some corn. We had some corn in the backyard and some big tomatoes and cherry tomatoes, some peas and some squash. We were having a pretty successful garden and we were pretty excited. We were eating really good, healthy food and having lots of fun. But then we ran into another problem. So, you know, we built the fence to keep the dogs out. But then because the dogs couldn't get in and the owl didn't move, the squirrels realized that we just grew them a salad bar. So then for a couple of seasons, we planted and we planted and we planted, and we would start to see the plants bear fruit or vegetables. We'd start to see green tomatoes form and we'd get excited and say, okay, they'll be ready in like a day, maybe 2 days. And we'd go out there and they'd be gone. We would get nothing out of our garden. It was so frustrating because we'd put time and money and sweat and effort into growing these vegetables, and we knew we could do it. We knew the soil was right. We were watering it right. We had made all this good, delicious stuff, but these squirrels were eating everything. So then we figured we got to do something, and then life came and threw us a curveball, and we started having these kids, and it's really, really hard to garden when you're carrying an infant. You can't get down in the dirt. You can't put your baby down in the dirt. Then your baby starts to crawl and put stuff in its mouth, and you don't want them eating dirt. And so for a couple more years, we had trouble having a garden because we didn't want to waste it and feed it to the squirrels, and we didn't know what to do with the babies in our arms. But now the kids are growing up. We've got a 5-year-old, and we've got toddlers, and we want to get them back involved in gardening and make it a part of their lives like it was a part of mine. But how are we going to do that with these squirrels? We thought and we thought and we thought. We didn't want to kill the squirrels. We couldn't chase them away. We still didn't want the dogs in the garden. So we came up with a plan. The next picture shows you. Oh, we started getting the kids involved. I forgot about this picture. We got the kids involved by starting the seeds inside, so that they could grow in a safe way inside, not be bothered by the squirrels and the birds and such. So they got to get their hands dirty. They got to poke holes in the dirt and plant the seed and cover it up and watch it grow inside the house, which was really great fun. But in the meantime, we were getting the garden ready to put the plants from the inside the house into the outside of the house. So we have built a squirrel-proof cage around the garden. We built it out of pipe and out of mesh so that the bees could still get into the garden and pollinate the plants, and you could still get some rain. And we put a plastic roof cover over it so it could still get lots of good sunshine, and a gate so that we could climb in and out, but the gate locks. So we did that a few weeks ago, and I want to show you, so far, that's what we have so far. The plants have grown beautifully because of all the rain and sunshine we've had. And so far, the squirrels have not figured out how to get in. You can see them in the trees looking, exploring the edges and trying to find ways, but so far we have a squirrel-proof garden, which is really exciting. The plants are flowering, and any day now we are going to have an abundance of vegetables. So if anybody wants to have some yummy, delicious garden vegetables, we're going to have more than we can possibly eat now because we're doing such a good job and we're not having to battle the squirrels anymore. Gardening is amazing fun. It is a lot of work, but it is so rewarding. It's better for your mind and your body and your heart than going to the HEB, going through the produce section, and picking up some vegetables. I encourage you, if you've never put a seed in the ground or in a pot in your house, dare your parents to get messy. Go to the store and get a pot and fill it with some dirt and put some flower seeds in there, or try planting some vegetables. You might have some squirrels come by your garden and eat some stuff, but it'll be worth the effort. It is so much fun to see a plant grow. And it connects you to one of the very, very first things that God ever did with the universe that God made. God created plants and animals and life and grew things in the garden and then formed us out of the dirt itself. It connects us to God when we grow things and we get down in the dirt and get messy. So I challenge you, I dare you, young people, parents, get messy. Plant something and watch it grow. The last slide is our prayer for today. Will you pray it with me? Dear God, thank you for everything that comes from the earth. For fruits and vegetables, flowers and trees, grasses and grains. We thank you for rain that waters the earth, and the people who grow, pick, and deliver the foods we eat. Amen. Friends, now we're going to get a chance to hear from another one of our elders. This is Keith White.
As Pastor Jen said, I am Keith White, also known as the tall guy in the choir. I'm here to tell you a little bit about the committee and encourage you to consider joining us. I'm also the chair of the Finance and Stewardship Committee. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Bible talks about gifts from the Holy Spirit. We know that there are different ways we can serve the Lord. Some may be called because of their gifts to serve on committees like worship or like buildings and grounds. That's great. It also says that we are one body with many parts. We are looking for the parts of the congregation that are interested in finances and numbers. And if you identify as a geek or nerd, and your calling is to review financial statements, then I have a job for you. On a monthly basis, we review the financial reports that we get from our accountant and from the foundation and present them to the Madison Square session. If numbers are not your kind of thing, in late summer, we will start planning our annual stewardship campaign. If being part of that effort is your special gift, we would love to have you on board for the campaign. As Margaret Erickson told you 2 weeks ago, as a congregation, we have been blessed by several Madison Square saints. We need to be good stewards of these gifts. If you want to help in this regard, send a note to me or the church office and let us know that you want to help with the committee or just be part of the stewardship campaign. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Esther. Let us pray for inspiration from God's Spirit. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer, in whose name I pray. Amen. Today's scripture comes from Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. Hear the word of God. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." Then Jesus says some other things, and the disciples ask him for an explanation of that parable, and he says this: "Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while, and when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the gospel of grace. Thanks be to God. Our sermon today is a continuation of our children's time. We're going to be talking a lot about dirt and gardening. As I said, I am a sower of seeds. I come from sowers of seeds. Both sides of my family had gardens, and the family that has taken me in is from the Amish country in Pennsylvania. We are all from farmland. Whenever we've gone on vacation in my childhood, it wasn't to beaches or snow-capped mountains or big cities. It was to places with front porches where we would shuck corn and eat homemade pickles and shell beans. We'd take trips out to apple orchards and peach orchards and make yummy things out of what we gathered. As long as there was a yard, as long as there was green space, there would be a garden. So, as I said, when I finally settled down and had a yard to call my own, a garden sprung up. But it wasn't anything like this story of the sower who would take a handful of seeds and throw them in an arc across his body, scattering them around acres and acres of land. In my vegetable garden, efficiency matters. The economy of the garden is something I care about deeply. We would lay out a plan on paper before we ever laid it out in the dirt, deciding what plants would go where based on sunlight and shade and water and efficiency of reaching in and grabbing things from the front without stepping on vines. Seed packets come with instructions about how deep to dig a hole and how much water to give it and how far to space it from another seed. It's mathematically precise. Because I have a limited amount of land and a variety of seeds to plant that grow at different heights and widths and depths. When I open a pack of seeds, which might cost all of 75 cents, I want every seed to count. I want everyone to yield 30 or 60 or 100 fold. And I'm not alone in my obsession for gardening maximization. In 1866, when the statistics were first released, corn farmers produced an average of 26 bushels per acre. That number stayed essentially unchanged until the 1940s, when advances in genetic engineering, fertilization, and insecticides took off. Productivity has climbed every year since then. And now the average production of corn per acre is 180 bushels. Went from 26 bushels an acre to 180 bushels an acre. The same amount of land is producing so much more these days. The same is true for other products, soy, wheat, even protein like chicken and pig and cow. Livestock used to free roam on ranges. Now we have these meat farms. It's more efficient, but it's less diverse and less healthy. But our world population has drastically increased too, and we have to feed people. In 1950, there were 2.5 billion people on Earth. Now there are nearly 8 billion people. And very few of us nowadays have our own gardens or livestock. We depend on mass production of meat and fruit and grain and vegetables. We would starve if we didn't have genetic engineering and genetically modified foods and these meat farms. But don't even get me started on the transportation of food. How on earth can we get yellow bananas and ripe squash and fresh seafood in South Central Texas any day of the week at any of the 10 grocery stores that are within 5 miles of my house? I don't understand how that process works. Pandemic or not, we have still had an abundance of food compared to other places on Earth. But there's a downside to this mass production of vegetables, minerals, livestock. I don't mean to scare anyone, but the United Nations says that we only have about 60 years of topsoil left on our planet. Between 1/3 and 1/2 of our topsoil from 150 years ago is gone. And we're losing it at a rate of about 1% a year. Topsoil is the outermost layer of soil, usually the top 5 to 10 inches. It has the highest concentration of organic matter and microorganisms, and it's where most of the Earth's biological soil activity occurs. Topsoil is composed of mineral particles, organic matter, water, and air. It's more porous, more airy than the soil that's compacted below it, so it can hold larger volumes of water and carbon and nitrogen. It's more nutrient dense and so can support the growth of vegetation. It's home to worms and other invisible organisms that break down organic matter and return nutrients to the soil that can then be used to grow new things. The erosion of topsoil causes catastrophic flooding, increases in wildfires, global warming, and the degradation of our waterways and freshwater fishing. Easy, Jin, I hear some of you saying at home. We'll just make more. We'll buy some at the garden center and put it on our lawns. Problem solved. Well, like most things in life, it's not that easy. We can't just throw money at it. Do you know how long it takes to make soil? Anywhere between 500 and 1,000 years to make 1 inch, and that depends on the climate you live in. Let me allow one of my favorite poets, a Kentucky native named Wendell Berry, to describe soil making for you. For many years, he writes, my walks have taken me down an old fence row in a wooded hollow on what was once my grandfather's farm. A battered galvanized bucket is hanging on a fence post near the head of the hollow, and I never go by without stopping to look inside. For what is going on in that bucket is the most momentous thing I know, the greatest miracle I have ever heard of. It is making earth. The old bucket has hung there through many autumns, and the leaves have fallen into it. Rain and snow have fallen into it, and the fallen leaves have held the moisture, and so have rotted. Nuts have fallen into it, or been carried into it by squirrels. Mice and squirrels have eaten the meats of the nuts and left the shells. They and other animals have left their droppings. Insects have flown into the bucket and died and decayed. Birds have scratched in it and left their droppings and maybe a feather or two. This slow work of growth and death, gravity and decay, which is the chief work of the world, has by now produced in the bottom of the bucket some black humus. I look into that bucket with fascination because I am a farmer of sorts and an artist of sorts. And I recognize there an artistry and a farming far superior to mine or to that of any human. Barry says that the bucket has been hanging there for almost 50 years and has produced a small amount of humus. Not hummus, the garbanzo bean dip that we put on pita, but humus. An almost indescribable combination of organic material, compost, worms, carbon, microorganisms, water, and air that is vital to plant growth. Why he keeps the bucket there for 50 years is a mystery to me. Why he doesn't take it and dump it in his garden is a mystery to me. He's fascinated by this bucket. And so I don't question him. Instead, I question my impatience and my demand for maximum economic return. We live in a world of speed and efficiency. We expect to solve even our biggest problems with money and ingenuity. Pandemic? Genetically create an mRNA vaccine in record time, scientifically brilliant and safe and effective, and give it to everybody for free. Russia builds a new missile system, we build an even better defensive and offensive system. Squirrels eating your garden? Build a squirrel-proof garden. Soil disappearing? Well, we're learning about what's called hydroponic farming, which is growing food without using soil. But it's an infant stage industry, and we still need soil. And so far, we have not been able to grow soil any faster than Mother Nature. But this is a problem we have to figure out, and we have to figure out fast. Soil is life, and we're running out of it. Soil is as important to us as oxygen and water, and it's important to God. There's a professor, Norman Wurzbach, who teaches theology and ecology at Duke University, and he writes this: Is it any wonder, then, that God loves soil? It is certainly true that God loves you and me. But when we first meet God in the garden, God is focused on and busy with the dirt. God is on God's knees, hands in the dirt, holding soil so close as to breathe into it the warm, loving, divine breath of life. And not just human life. Plants and animals and birds came out of the same ground. Soil is the earthly center and connector through which God gardens life into vibrant, beautiful, and delectable reality. God is the first, best, and most essential gardener in the world. I love the scripture verse that says that we were made in the image of God from the dirt. But I think that all of creation was made in the image of God. And what I've learned this week is that good soil is absolutely a reflection of God. Because Wurzbach goes on to say, one way to describe soil is to say that it is not stingy. While it holds a bewildering variety of nutrients closely together, it also lets go lightly. If it did not, life could not develop freely out of it. Think, for instance, of what must happen for a seed to sprout and grow. It must, as John put it in his gospel, enter into the soil and die if it is to bear much fruit. But upon entering the soil, it does not pass into some kind of passive medium. The soil is itself alive, embroiled in digestive and transformative processes that receive the seed's dissolution and then nurtures it back into plant life. Seeds germinate because the soil is that welcoming place in which minerals, water, clay, microorganisms, worms, and heat have already been long at work. What healthy soil does is release and bring to light all the possibilities that are latent within a particular seed, even if those possibilities, like thorns or weeds, are not to our particular liking or benefit. Good soil takes the seed's potential and works with it. That's why a writer and tree expert named William Logan quite rightly says, hospitality is the fundamental virtue of the soil. It makes room. It shares. It neutralizes poisons, and so it heals. This is what the soil teaches, he says. If you want to be remembered, give yourself away. Have you ever heard more beautiful language about dirt? Language that mirrors the triune nature of God. Language that mirrors the nature of Christ. Language that mirrors what the church is supposed to be. I haven't before. I got goosebumps when I read this for the first time. It's no wonder that the words humus, human, and humility all have the same root. No pun intended. Literally meaning dirt, from the dirt, and grounded to the dirt. All of life is intimately tied to the soil. The best of humans are humble, rooted to their community, adaptable, vibrant, empowering of others, and generous, like good soil. In today's scripture, we hear a parable that is familiar to many Christians. And we hear Jesus explaining the scripture. You don't need me to mansplain Jesus. It's remarkably clear already. Instead, I want to ask a different question. What are we going to do when there's no good soil left? When Jesus says that the sower sowed on different types of soil, he points out how inefficient growth is without good soil. There is no harvest whatsoever from the seed on the path, the seed on the rocky ground, or the seed on the thorny ground. Now, I'll give you that we've all seen a weed or a flower grow out of a crack in the sidewalk and been inspired. Or we've seen the tree when we take the boat on the riverwalk that comes out of the side of the stony building. We've seen bluebonnets thriving in patches of weeds where they are allowed to live amongst the weeds because legally in the state of Texas, we can't mow them down. We know plants are resilient and that nature is a force. But it's generally true that gardeners don't want to plant seeds in any ground that's like these three conditions. It doesn't make much sense to me at all that the sower would deliberately scatter seeds in such a haphazard way that would cause the seed to land in such inefficient places. Even in ancient times, if a sower came upon a path, you would stop the arc of your arm before you scatter it over the path. You have that control. See, when it comes to judging soil, I'm a pro. I can use a critical eye and a shovel and make an accurate determination of what ground I'm working with. I can tell the difference between a path and a rocky ground and a weedy ground and a good ground. But so can you. It's not rocket science. However, when it comes to judging people, I'm not so good. I don't go in with a scalpel or a CT scan or a psychological profile and determine what I'm working with. I can only see the surface, and that's where I can get into trouble. If I look at someone's possessions and body language and other superficial factors, I can jump to conclusions pretty easily. I can judge whether or not it's worthwhile to invest the time and energy into them. But I can be dead wrong. Because some people look like good soil, but have been so hardened by the world that they're as tough as concrete inside. Some people look good, but have no depth. They'll volunteer and then quit. Sign up and then make excuses. Have faith in the good times and lose it in the bad. And some people, as Jesus says, will be distracted by the cares of the world and the lure of wealth. But to my eye, they might present as pretty good soil on the surface. And the opposite can be true. Someone can be metaphorically covered in decomposing leaves, compost, stink like manure, and to me, they don't look appealing at all. But to folks like God and Wendell Berry and Professor Norman Wiersbe, those are the best looking folks of all. They're ready to hear the good news and absorb it, nurture it, bring out the potential in it, and thrive. I still have a lot to learn about judging a human's heart and readiness for the good news. In our parable today, Jesus isn't talking about Christians learning how to garden. In this rare example, Jesus explains the parable, and it's about human hearts receiving and hearing the message about the kingdom of God. But there's still a lot of we can learn about human hearts by considering what good soil is all about. Because what I've come to understand this week is that good soil isn't just the absence of rocks and weeds and footprints. It's the presence of so many things that make it very much alive. A relationship, a community living together in the soil. It's constantly changing and adapting. It's making room for life and death. It's giving and receiving in a free exchange of resources. It is a community of living things. It's a composition of many things. It's a great metaphor for church. We are the ever-changing, ever mortal, ever dirty, ever life-giving, ever necessary and vulnerable and resilient and essential place where God can scatter seed and it can be absorbed into the living, breathing humus that we are. We don't want to be hardened by life and unable to receive the seeds. We don't want to be shallow and unable to give them room and support them in their growth. We don't want to be distracted or selfish. We want to add to an ongoing process that has been years in the making and work our magic and fulfill the potential of the seed. But being good soil takes a lot of time and effort. And above all else, it absolutely must be messy. There must be a balance of life and death, manure and vegetation, water and sunlight. But the problem is, we don't do messy very well. We keep our yards, our churches, and our personal lives very neat. We have to. According to my homeowners association and the little voices whispering in our consciences about how our yard looks compared to our neighbors, I can't allow the leaves to decompose on my grass. I can't let the grass get too tall and shadow the ground to protect it from the heat. I can't throw banana peels and watermelon rinds and the leftover dinner that my twins didn't finish on my front yard. It's considered rude. We have an organics bucket for all of that. And the city hauls it off for me on Fridays. I don't even get to keep it. And in church, we can't share the decay that's going on in our lives. We can't shed light on the muck and the emotions that we're going through because our pastor left, or because we're reopening too fast, or that we're not opening fast enough, or that we haven't done this, or we haven't done that, because it's not so seemly to be so messy. But in the meantime, we're losing our topsoil. Our ground is getting harder and rockier, and it's getting more and more difficult for seeds of good news of the kingdom to grow in churches. Is it worth it? Is it worth the effort to get down in the dirt and dig out the rocks and pull out the weeds and save our organic material and compost it when we could just go to the HEB and get any fresh vegetables we want in any quantity, no matter the time of year, for a reasonable price? Yes. Working in the dirt is hard. It is messy. It is primitive. But Wurzba says, and I quote, "Soil is the most mundane, yet forever mysterious place where we regularly meet God's hospitable love for life." And Wendell Berry says, "The topsoil is very Christ-like in its passivity and in the penetrating energy that issues out of its peaceableness. It increases by experience, by the passage of seasons over it, growth rising out of it and returning to it, not by ambition or aggressiveness. It is enriched by all things that die and enter into it. It keeps the past not as a history or memory, but as richness, as new possibility. The soil is the great connector of lives, the source and destination of all of us. It is the healer and restorer and resurrector by which disease passes into health, age into youth, death into life. Without proper care for it, we can have no community, because without proper care for it, we can have no life." These two lovers of dirt write so beautifully. I commend you to read more of their works, but most importantly, I commend you to go and get dirty. Be good soil. Make good soil. Give thanks to God for soil. Play in it. Get it under your nails and in your hair and kneel down in it in some old jeans. It is a precious resource. The glaciers are melting. The forests are burning. The soil is eroding. But God is the first and greatest gardener. And so it's never too late. May God and God's people do what can be done to cherish, protect, and grow the good soil on earth and in our hearts. Amen. I never thought I'd get so excited about dirt. Friends, it is time to continue our worship by giving back part of what God has given to us. If part of that giving today is for you to give to the kingdom work through the life and ministry of Madison Square, then I encourage you to do so at this time, or to put a reminder in your mind or heart or phone to do so later online, or by writing a check and mailing it in. But as you consider what you would give to God, let us continue in our worship.
you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my name be known? Will you let my life be grown in you and you in me? Will you leave yourself behind if I but call your name? Will you care for cruel mankind never be the same? Will you risk the hostile stare should your life attract or scare? Will you let me answer prayer in you and you in me? Will you let the blinded see if I but call your name? Will you set the prisoners free and never be the same? Will you kiss the leper clean and do such as this unseen and admit to what I mean in you and you in me? Will you love the you hide if I but call your name? Will you quell the fear inside and never be the same? Will you use the faith you found to reshape the world around through my sight and touch and sound in you and you in me? Lord, the summons echoes true when you but call my name. Let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go where your love and footsteps show, and live and grow and you in me.
The Holy One be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
Holy One, creator of the universe, namer of stars and twirler of planets, you've set all things in motion. You've seen the supernovas and the asteroids, the ice ages, volcanoes erupting and fires burning. You created all things in such a way that life continues to expand and grow. Nothing is fixed and static. The world is resilient, mysterious, marvelous. When oil pipelines gush in the water, ocean creatures digest and process oil, and humans assist in cleaning up. When fires destroy forests, trees drop seeds, and new life begins, and humans assist in new growth. When rivers are diverted, a ripple effect of ecology occurs, and life adapts in breathtaking ways. But we have not always been as responsive to the earth as it is to itself. We assume that anything meant for our good is worth the price to be paid, and we have dug up, dammed up, paved over, and chopped down whatever we have wanted. Forgive us, God, for neglecting your first commandment to us, to steward the magnificent world around us. We give you thanks for your care of the earth, performing us from dust and returning our bodies to it. We give you thanks for the variety of life that we can enjoy, for the diversity of places we can go, for the universal impulse of children to jump in mud. We thank you for this earth and ask your blessing upon it. We pray for wisdom and courage and vision to transform our cultural expectations about the land into something that matches the dire situation we are in. And today we also pray for our brothers and sisters in Cuba. We pray passionately for their safety and their health, their ability to care for each other and for their community, and that their faith would be strong in these difficult times. We pray for Carl, who spent the last 2.5 days traveling and is spending the first precious hours back home right now. We pray for the family and friends of Shannon Hawthorne, a former member and friend to many who died recently. We pray for Emil and Melissa and Michelle and Damaso and their continuing journeys toward restoration of full health. We pray for Frank, who will have surgery on Tuesday, that all would go well and that he would recover quickly. We pray for Mary Ann and her mother, her father and her stepfather, all struggling and in need of your grace. We pray for friends of Mary Ann, the Loftons and Collins family, as they struggle with the loss of 12-year-old Kennedy. We pray for Jonathan. We pray for Reverend Kreutzer, who will join us in just 3 more Sundays, and for the whole church as we prepare to open the sanctuary doors next week. God, we know that this pandemic is not over yet, that there are people in our community struggling even this very moment, and we pray for an increase in vaccinations and an end to this chapter in our lives. Oh God, you have breathed life into the soil from the beginning. You made it to be as interrelational and complex as your Trinitarian self. You call us to remember our origins, to stay close to the earth, to be creatures of dust. In the name of Jesus, we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we close our worship service, I'm serious about that challenge. I encourage you to find time to plant a seed in a flower pot in your home, outdoors in a flower bed, a vegetable, a fruit, it doesn't matter. Just get your hands dirty. It's good for you. And let us say the benediction together. The good news has been lovingly planted in our souls.
We will bear good fruit.
It takes root deep inside of us.
When storms shall come, we will not be uprooted.
Distractions, droughts, pandemics, and pests may impede our growth, but
God is for us and is excited to watch us grow.
So grow, people of God. Go out in peace and do God's work, planting seeds of good news. Amen.